Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. It's an honor to be with you tonight, and what beautiful worship is in the house of the Lord. Amen. We may be in a hotel ballroom, but anywhere we get together and worship the Lord is the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And it's so inspiring to hear of the people here from India, from China, and from Indonesia, and all of the cultures represented. As you were welcoming those from different countries, I was wondering how many cultures are represented. And the menagerie, the mix of people that is here, it's beautiful to me. It truly must be a picture of what heaven's going to be like. Amen. Except when we get to heaven, there'll be no need of translation. There'll be no division because of our languages. But one people, one bride of Christ, worshiping the Lord completely. Pastor Bobby made reference to Isaiah. And Isaiah said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. He goes on to say, woe unto me, for I am a man of unclean lips. But in the first five chapters of Isaiah, that's chapter 6. In the first five chapters of Isaiah, Isaiah doesn't say, woe is me. 6 times Isaiah says, woe unto you. Said, you're like a vineyard broken down. Woe unto you. Woe unto you, you're like houses that have not been kept. Woe unto you. Woe unto you, you have failed. Woe unto you, you're broken down. Woe unto you. But when Isaiah got in the presence of the Lord, his focus shifted from what was broken everywhere else. And he said, woe unto me. That's what the presence of God will do for you. It'll move your eyes from all the trouble and put them on yourself. It'll cause you to begin to see God for who he is. When Isaiah finally saw God for who he was, he didn't repent of his actions. He didn't repent of his thoughts. He repented of his words. Because I've been speaking the wrong thing about God. I've been focusing on what can't be done, what trouble there is. But the moment he saw God lifted up, he said, oh, it's my mouth with which I have sinned. Amen. And he began to speak differently. It was then, he was a prophet of doom. But after he saw the Lord, he became the man who prophesied more about the coming of Messiah than any other man. It's just literally a few chapters later, he said, there's one coming, and thou shalt call his name.
Yes.
Emmanuel, God's with us. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. That's what getting in the presence of God will do. It'll change your perspective. You may be seated. I'm going to continue in the same vein that I began today. For those of you that were here in service with us, we begin to touch a little bit on faith and the working of faith. And I'd just like to stay in that vein. I'm going to stay somewhat slower in my pace as I did today and teach. And I'd like you to hear what the Lord would say. Would you do that? So before I begin, grab someone's hand and we're going to pray for God to speak to us. Would you pray right now? Say, speak, Lord. Speak to us tonight, God. Speak to us tonight. Let your word find a resting place in our hearts. In the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen.
Amen.
The music was just sensational tonight. Thank you. The worship team, what a great job you've done. I'd like to remind you tonight of God's promises. That is my mission, to prompt you to remember the pattern of God's actions in your past. I'd like to speak until your boldness becomes stirred. Because I'd like you to align your purpose with God's promise. And I believe it's imperative, important, that you weave into the fabric of your faith God's promises. Every time God ever presents a significant opportunity, it is always formed within crisis. Opportunities are connected to danger. They come at a great cost. Tragedy is the soil of the miraculous. There is not a single miracle in the Word of God that does not involve affliction. Did you hear that? There is not one miracle in the Word of God that did not first begin with affliction. Barren wombs lead to miraculous births. In fact, I mentioned it today for just a moment. The three women, statistically, it's an anomaly that one would be barren in the Old Testament. And yet, God's promise to Abraham is to a barren Sarah. And then Abraham and Sarah, after her barrenness is removed, have Isaac. Isaac's wife, Rebekah, is barren. And yet, finally, ultimately, what happens? There is a child born, and there are two twins, Esau and Jacob, and they wrestle. And Jacob's favored wife, Rachel, is barren. Statistically, the probability of three generations in a row, every single woman being born barren, is highly unlikely. But God delights in doing the supernatural in the most unusual of people and places. And so understand the affliction or the crises, the challenge in your own life. God delights in taking that challenge and doing something incredible. God likes to bring revival to China under cover. Behind the scenes, in a quiet church underground somewhere, that's what God likes to do. God likes to bring revival in the unlikeliest of places. Joseph is sold into slavery, and the result is one of the greatest examples of forgiveness in human history, because God likes to do things in the most unlikely of places. The cruel bondage of Egypt results in the promised land and the Exodus and all the miracles, because God likes to begin in crises. The gruesome death of Jesus Christ on a cross reveals his power of triumph over tragedy. Let me tell you something very important. Repeat this with me. Say, God's capacity will always exceed my boldness. Does that make sense to you? You will never be too bold. You will never pray too big a prayer. You will never put God in an awkward position. You will never place God in an embarrassing position. You will never back God into a corner. You will never challenge God in your faith beyond his ability to respond. You will never pray a prayer that God is incapable of answering. You will never ask God to do something it is impossible for him to accomplish. For there will never be a moment when your faith surpasses God's ability to respond. Think about that for a moment. You can't pray a big enough prayer. That's why the writer said, it is beyond our capacity to think, to ask, or even think what God is capable of doing. You will never pray a prayer too big. So I'm challenging every person at camp meeting, pray big prayers. Dream big dreams. Ask the impossible. Hope for the unlikely. Isaiah 43 and verse 13. Yea, before the day was, I am. I am he, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand, for I will work. Who will let it? You know, if I was to take a survey tonight and I was to ask you, what is the scripture that symbolizes who we are? There would be quite a difference of opinion. Some would immediately quote Acts 2:38. Then Peter said it to them. Others would say, well, it's not that. It's ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock. And others would say, Hebrews 11 and 1, without faith, it's impossible to please, or to Hebrews 11 and 6, impossible to please him. And the answers would be as different as the people in this room. And there was a scribe that asked Jesus that question. What's the greatest commandment? What is the core of who you are and what you believe and what you teach? And Jesus summed up all the commandments with this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Now, that scripture is Jesus quoting the Shema or Deuteronomy 6 and 4. It was the greatest of all commandments. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Now, I would like everyone in this house to know God is one. God is one. And God being one is the foundation of everything you could ever understand about God. I want you to understand, it's more than meaning that he's not a part of a pantheon of other gods. But when Jesus declares that the greatest commandment is that God is one, what it means is this, that there is no division or there is no composition, there is no partial makeup of who he is. That God is whatever he is, in the most pure way possible. God is pure. Say, God is pure. In his essence. So that means that there is no characteristic that can apply to him in a partial way or a limited way. If God is holy, then God is perfectly holy. Does that make sense to you? In other words, the God you're worshiping tonight, he's like a flawless diamond. You see, when you say that a gem or a diamond is without flaws, you mean that it contains no cracks, that it contains no combination of different materials, that there are no other colors, that it is transparent, that it is one thing only. That is God. God is God all by himself. That's what he said. He said, I am God alone. And like me, there is none else. So God is what he is absolutely, completely. He is divine oneness. There is no group of other gods. There are no other entities capable of adding anything to God, or even taking anything away from God, because God is beyond the power of any other thing in the universe. Simply said, and we use this word, God is omnipotent, or God is all powerful. Now, this is important that you understand this beginning of this sermon. So God is all powerful. He's not a combination of things. He is pure, perfect oneness. Nothing can be added to him. Nothing can be taken away from him. God doesn't change. He is perfect. Because change requires a combination of two things. It requires a cause and an effect. And the Word wants you to know. And Jesus said, before you focus on any other commandments, get this one commandment right. There's no change within him. There's no force on the outside of God that can make him change. Nor is there anything within him that can cause him to change. For God does not tire. God does not grow weary. God does not rust. God does not age. God does not get sick. God does not have a bad day. God is God, perfectly pure. So there's no combination outside of him. There's nothing within him that can cause God to change. So God is never stressed. God is never sleepless. God is never anxious. God is never worried. God is never without an answer. God knows all things. So if God doesn't change, then that means God doesn't grow. God doesn't learn. You know, there are some theologians today that are trying to teach a new doctrine that God is learning. That as God takes over time and that as God exists, that God is adding to his wisdom simple parts of wisdom. But let me make it clear. If God were to learn, then God would be changing. And God said it about himself, I do not change. I change not. I, the Lord, change not. Jesus said it. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if God was adding knowledge, then God would be changing. So God doesn't change. God is all powerful and God is pure. And also God is omniscient. God is present everywhere. And not only is he present everywhere, he exists throughout the universe simultaneously. He's in you and he's in me. He's in America and he's in Indonesia. All at the same time. Is your mind blown yet? Think about God. You see, if you don't believe that God is present everywhere, then the only alternative is he's present some places and not other places. And what kind of God would that be? We would have to convince him to show up at camp meeting. We would have to bargain with him to make an appointment so we could meet with him. But God is present everywhere. The moment you speak his name, he shows up. When you're all alone in the night and begin to reach toward him, you feel his presence. Why? Because he was already there. The scripture in the English says that he is a very present help in time of trouble. It's one of my favorite because it has that word very present. You know what that means? He's present before you were present. He's present before you needed him to be present. He was where you needed him to be before you needed him to be there. He was healing before you got sick. He was an answer before you had a question. He was peace before you were in chaos. He is a very present help in time of your trouble. He is there before you get where you need him to be. Now watch. So if it were true, then God, if he was only present here and there, then his state would be different in each place he is. In other words, God would change when he moved from space to space. God would change. And yet God can't change. So that means wherever I am, God is always the same. No wonder the writer David said, if I make my bed in hell, thou art there. And if I ascend into the heavens, thou art there. If I catch the wings and fly to the beginning of the morning, I can't escape your presence. No matter where I go, you're there. You're present everywhere. We've been singing about it all night, and we've been talking about the greatness of God, and we've been singing about his glory. So let's talk about it for a moment. Well, James 1:17, I'll just tell you what it says. Okay, no one's there to put it up. But James 1:17, you ready? It said, every good and perfect gift. Yep. Sounds like you can quote it. Quote it.
Comes from above.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
From where?
Above.
Down from?
The Father.
The Father of what? Of lights, yeah. So you know what? And while you're doing that, put that background of stars up for me. So ready? So watch this. So every good and every perfect gift comes from above, down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, nor shadow of turning. Now, can I explain this verse just a little bit? Because the scripture says that we look to the heavens and the heavens declare his greatness, correct? So James wants to teach you about the God you worship. And James wants to make sure you know that every good thing in your life is not because you're intelligent. It's not because you've worked hard. It's not because you're born in a certain country. It's not because you've been given an advantage. That every good thing in your life is a derivative of God's greatness. It is a gift of God's grace. Every blessing in your life is because God is great. Amen? So James begins to use the heavens as an example. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. So understand, if we use, and then he says, and cometh down from the Father of lights. So now, the Father of lights in the natural is the sun. But the Father of lights in the spiritual is our God. So let's take the sun to explain this verse. So if we turned off the sun tonight, everything in our life would dissolve. All the gravitational forces would fall apart. We would move into chaos, and extreme cold would overtake us, and life as we know it would be extinguished. Because you can't live without the natural sun. Consequently, you can't live without Almighty God. Yes. You have to have him in your life, and he is the constant from which we revolve around. Now, some people think the world revolves around them, but we revolve around God. You understand that, right? We revolve around God. In fact, we revolve around him at 23 degrees. We're tilted at a particular axis. It doesn't feel like that tonight, but we are. We are tilted on our axis of 23 degrees. And incidentally, if we just moved off 23 degrees by 3/4 of a degree, we would either burn up or freeze to death, depending on which way we rocked. I'm glad God's in control. So remember, every good gift, and I wrote these down because you don't use mile per hours, but listen to this. So we're revolving around the sun, or we're spinning on our axis at 23 degrees at 1,000 miles per hour. And I wrote this down because I don't know kilometers. You are moving at 1,600 kilometers an hour. Anybody ever driven that fast? So you're moving at 1,600 kilometers an hour as you spin on this axis. Now, if that wasn't enough to overwhelm you of God's greatness, you are then orbiting the sun while you spin on your axis at 1,600 kilometers an hour. Are you ready? You're orbiting the sun at 107,000 kilometers per hour. So you are hurtling through space, spinning in a circle, revolving around the sun. But it doesn't stop there. The sun and the earth are making a trip around the axis of the galaxy. And guess what they're spinning at? You ready? An additional 70,000 kilometers an hour. So not only am I spinning like this, not only am I moving around this orbit, that the sun and the earth are moving throughout the Milky Way, revolving around an axis, but it doesn't even stop there. The Milky Way is moving on an axis, spinning through space. You're really ready for this one? At 792,000 kilometers an hour. Every good and every perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights. So James says, everything you have is owned by God himself. It's part of his structure and his order for your life. And if the word of God that sustains all things were to cease, all things would fall into chaos. So watch this. But here's the problem. Even when you try to use the heavens and the magnitude of their glory to describe God, they fall short. Because now he says, not only is all life upheld by the sun, all life upheld by God, this God you worship, he has no variableness. Variableness, what does that mean? Guess. Change. It means change. Okay, but it means a little bit more than change. It's actually the Greek word in the original translation, and it's parallax. It's where you would get the English word parallax. I have no idea what in your language what that word may be, but I'll explain what parallax is because it's very important you understand this. Parallax, how many have ever looked through a telescope or looked through a binocular? You ever done that? And did you notice that when you looked through that lens, if you got it too close, a black circle closed down? And if you pulled it away, it opened up, but if you got it too far, the black circle closed back down. How many have ever experienced that? That's parallax. In other words, you have to have it at the perfect distance from your eye to see clearly. Too far away, it closes. Too close, it closes. That's parallax. Parallax is the calculation between the ability of your eye to see through the lens. Now, why is this important? Because in God, there is no parallax. There is no variableness. In other words, I'm going to make this very clear, and it's going to radically transform your faith in a few moments before I'm done. What it means is this. So when the United States of America put someone on the moon, okay, we actually did that. When we put someone on the moon, now some people don't believe we did, but we really did do that. Okay. When we put someone on the moon, we just didn't take a rocket and throw it up there and hope that it hit it. We had to calculate the velocity of the earth coordinating with the revolving of the earth and the stationary orbit of the moon around the earth. We had to factor in all of those issues, but then lastly, we had to factor in parallax because the relationship of the moon changes from where you are on the earth. If you're near the North Pole, it appears closer. If you're at the South Pole, at certain times of the year, it's farther away. If you're at the equator, in fact, you know when I told you that we're spinning at 1,000 miles or 1,600 kilometers an hour? It's only at the equator that we move that fast. If you're up at the North Pole, you move a little slower. That's parallax. So the relationship to the object is different where you are. You had no idea it was a science class tonight, did you? But watch this. Okay. You're going to like it. So, it does something to me when you start thinking about the greatness of God. So here we are. And so now what it means is you always have to factor in parallax when you're dealing with a distant object because it's the only way you can truly know you're positioned correctly. You got to get the right spot because it appears different no matter where you are. Not God. God doesn't have any parallax. Come here, Pastor. Let me show you this illustration. So in other words, God is always the same distance from me, no matter where I am. So when I'm at my worst, he's, stand up. He's the same place. When I'm at my best, he's at the same place. When I'm in the valley, he's the same distance from me. When I'm on the mountain, he's the same distance from me. In other words, there's never a shifting in his relationship to who I am or what I am, no matter what I'm going through, no matter what country I live in, no matter what difficulty I'm facing, he's always the same distance from me, no matter what I do, because there is no variableness. There is no change within him. He's perfectly pure what he is. Now it even gets better. Okay, you ready? Yes. So we're the same distance, but just stay right here. Okay? You're the sun.
Okay.
I'm the earth. My face is right now in what? It's in light, correct?
That's right.
But when I turn on my orbit, my face is in shadow or darkness, correct? So what's it say? Not only is he always the same distance from me, regardless of my relative position to him. So see, understand this. Let me tell you something. It's not God that changes. It's us. It's not God that shifts. It's us. If you feel him less real right now, it's not because God's any farther apart, farther away. God is still just as close to you as he was the very first day you ever felt him. He hasn't changed. Not only that, there's no shadow of turning within him. In other words, when I turn, he turns. When I move, He moves. Because my face is never in shadow. I'm never in darkness. I'm never farther away from him. He's never distant from me. That's what James is trying to tell you. And that's what God says. Jesus says is the greatest commandment. Is you gotta understand my nature. You gotta understand my authority, my sovereignty, my power, and my oneness. God is never far away from us. As real as he was the first night you received the Spirit, he's just as real right now. As real as he was when God healed your body and you received a miracle, he is just as close right now. And no matter how life spins you, no matter how life turns you, no matter how chaotic it feels, he's just right there with you.
Amen.
Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
So let's go on then. So now, you can sit down. I might use you again in a minute. So in other words, everyone say there's no change in God. He is perfectly pure, all-powerful, unchanging, ever-present, all-knowing. In other words, God is flawless. God is one. So let me explain it like this. Whatever explains God, say whatever explains God. God is the perfect example of whatever explains him. You say, that doesn't even make sense. Sure it does. If God is faithful, God is perfectly faithful. If God is holy, God is perfectly holy. If God is just, God is perfectly just. If God is righteous, God is perfectly righteous. If God is powerful, he is perfect power. If God is mighty, he is perfect authority. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's why it's so important you understand this reality, that God is one. He's not like the Egyptians' God, who is this pantheon of confusion. He's not subject to the petty whims and jealousies of the Mesopotamians or the Romans and their false belief systems. He is one. He's perfect all by himself, and he is the perfect example of whatever he is. So if God is good, he is perfectly good. Otherwise, God would be like me, sometimes good and sometimes bad, sometimes right, sometimes wrong, sometimes funny, sometimes not. But God is whatever he is in the most perfect way possible. And you say to me, Brother Tisdale, it seems so complicated. What does that matter to me? I'll tell you what it matters. This is it. God can't do anything halfway, because it's impossible for him to be inconsistent. So if God has blessed Pastor Bobby, he'll bless your church. If God has healed me, he'll heal you, because he is the perfect example of justness, of righteousness, of holiness. So God can't engage in halfway measures. He can't bring you part of the way out of your situation and then let go. He's got to bring you all the way out, because once deliverance begins, deliverance has to finish. Am I making a little bit of sense? Once healing begins, healing has to finish, because God can't do anything part way, impartial or incomplete, because he is completely perfect. Shout it. Say, God is one.
God is one.
And why is this important? Because when you begin to see this reality, Jesus said, if you can understand this about me, you'll see something about me that will fuel your faith when things get difficult. And when the adversary tries to destroy your future, you'll begin to see something. Watch this. 2 Timothy 2 and 13. Put it on the board. This is probably one of my favorite scriptures. 2 Timothy 2 and 13. If we believe not, say, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. Why? Because he can't deny himself. Because he is made up of perfect faithfulness. So he's not fickle. He doesn't change his mind. He's not schizophrenic. He's not confused. He's not bipolar. Do you have all those terms in Malaysia and China? Yeah? Do they try to label people bipolar and schizophrenic and confused? That's not God. God doesn't change his mind today and be something different tomorrow. So look at it. If you don't believe, that's okay. He's still faithful. If your faith struggles, that's all right. He's still faithful. If you're uncertain, be uncertain. God is not uncertain. God is faithful. And this is why he cannot, say he cannot, deny himself. That means he can't refute the reality of what he is. He's perfectly pure. He's oneness. He's perfectly just. He's perfectly holy. So God can't be unfaithful. It's not because he's a nice God. It's not because he's a good God. It's because he can't be unfaithful. It is impossible for him to leave you stranded. It is impossible for him not to be a comforter. It is impossible for him not to be a healer. It is impossible for him not to help you spiritually and financially, because he cannot be unfaithful. He has bound himself by the reality of his own word. You can't be anybody but you. Your fingerprints are unique. The iris in your eye is unique. The facial structure of your bones are unique. You are a unique creation. Your DNA structure, your signature is unique. No one has your DNA but you. Even identical twins have a difference in their DNA. You can only be you. You can change your hairdo. You can change your hair color. You can change the way you dress. You can have all kinds of surgeries. But you're still you. Because you can only be you. And just like you can only be you, God can't be anyone but God. Amen. So God can't be it today and not be God tomorrow. God can't be fake tomorrow. God can't be unfaithful tomorrow. God can't be dishonest tomorrow. God cannot lie tomorrow. God cannot fail tomorrow, because he cannot violate the reality of what he is. So although we struggle in our faith, although we struggle in our hopes, God cannot deny himself. He will be faithful. He will be righteous. I'm here to tell you a very simple truth. That, remember, he can't move any farther away than he has already been, because he can't break structure. He can't refute his reality. He will always be close to you. He will always be near to you. He will always be your healer. God is faithful. Say it about him right now. Say, God is faithful.
God is faithful.
Say it like you mean it. Say, God is faithful.
God is faithful.
Say, God is holy.
God is.
Why don't you start describing him right now in your worship? Why don't you say, you're righteous, you're mighty, you're powerful, you're glorious, you're strong, you're unique. You move with all dominion. Go ahead, say it all over this house. There's nobody like you, God. There's no one like you, God. You're faithful. You're righteous. You're glorious. You're powerful. I don't know what chaos is in your life. I don't know what confusion you're confronted by. I don't know what pain is in your body. I don't know what need you need God to take over tonight. But I know this. God cannot be fair today and unfair tomorrow. God cannot be a healer today and not a healer tomorrow. Because he can't violate who he is. And God is faithful. That's why, as we ministered this morning when we went to Hebrews 11:11. Even though Sarah's body was dead, even though she had learned that she could not have children by means of Abraham giving a baby to Hagar, she began to count up and judge him faithful who had promised. And when you begin to judge God's faithfulness and you understand a singular reality, that God cannot be anything but faithful, you can believe for the impossible. You can begin to ask for the things that you don't think could happen. You can begin to pray big prayers, bigger than your ability to answer, because you suddenly know God cannot be unfaithful. True faith only begins where our intelligence reaches its limitation. When you finally arrive at the point that you realize, I can't make a difference, I can't change this, that's when real faith begins. And faith isn't measured by the length of your prayers. Faith isn't measured by the number of degrees behind your name. Faith isn't measured by how much money you have in the bank. Faith isn't measured by how productive your life has been. Faith is measured by saying, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Faith is being strong in affliction. Faith is being tough in battle. Faith is being relentless in prayer. Faith is standing when others are sitting. Faith is refusing to be manipulated. Faith is sitting on the side of the road and saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Faith doesn't quit. Faith doesn't give up. Faith stands on the reality of who Jesus is. Amen. That's why Psalms 1 said, a blessed man walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. For his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in that law doth he meditate day and night. You see, it's a downward negative progression. A cursed man listens to the wrong words. A cursed man partners with people that speak the wrong ideas. But look, a blessed man is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. It doesn't just mean sinners. I know saved people who give very ungodly counsel, who speak words that do not align with the word of God. You only can balance their counsel by the word. The word is the final authority. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Watch. Next verse, watch, or next phrase. Nor standeth in the way of sinners. So look, he's walking, but he hears the wrong words and he stops moving. And then he stands with people he would not normally stand with in agreement. And if he agrees with those wrong people long enough, he will sit down in scorn and mockery of the things of God. That's what the wrong counsel will do. It will stop your movement and it will sit you down in mockery of the things of God. And what used to bring you joy no longer brings you joy. But a blessed man finds his delight in the law. You know what the law is? The law, the word law here means the structure. A blessed man finds his delight, his strength in the structure of God. He can't be unfaithful. He's not flexible. He doesn't change. He's always holy. He's always righteous. A blessed man takes solace, comfort, strength in the reality of the God he worships. And then look, and then in that law, now that's a different word in the Hebrew. That law means that he takes in the law, in the commandments of the Lord. So not only does he delight in the structure, then in the commandments of the Lord, he meditates. The word meditate means literally to talk to yourself, to speak to yourself. So a blessed man tells himself, when I'm unfaithful, God is faithful. For he cannot deny himself. And a blessed man tells himself, I'm above and not beneath. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. A blessed man tells himself, I shall overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. A blessed man tells himself, I'm the head, not the tail. A blessed man tells himself, a righteous man may fall 7 times, but he arises. A blessed man tells himself, oh yeah, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall raise up a standard against it. So a blessed man takes his confidence in the reality of the God he serves, and then he counsels, he talks to himself about the promises of God. And what happens? Verse 3, you're like a tree that is planted. You're not haphazardly dropped. You're not thrown. You're not forgotten, but you are planted where you will perform your best, where you will produce your best, where you will have your own fruit. That's why you don't have to panic when someone else is blessed. That's why you don't have to get jealous when someone else gets a blessing. Because if you're telling yourself, there's no one like my God, and you're telling find yourself quoting the words of God. God will put you where you will produce fruit, and the fruit you produce will be your own season. Nobody else can take it. The devil can't stop it. People can't steal it. You won't miss it, but you just gotta take your confidence in who God is and what God says about you. Does that make sense to you? So look, not only that, not only do you bring forth fruit, your leaf doesn't wither, and whatsoever you do shall prosper. Say it about yourself. Say, whatever I do, it's going to prosper. Say it like you mean it. Say, whatever I do, it's going to prosper. Now, I want you to do two things for me before I go any farther. I want you to raise your hands and take strength from the reality, the structure of who God is. I want you to give God praise for the structure of who He is. He's faithful. He's righteous. He's holy. He's just. He's powerful. He's all-knowing. He's consistent. He's glorious. He's unique. He's holy. Now begin to quote scriptures about yourself. Say, greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. Oh, yeah, say it. Say it. Say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and they fell. Though a host should encamp against me, the war should rise against me, in this one thing will I be confident, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Oh, yeah, go ahead. Quote it about yourself. Greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. Say it about yourself. A just man falls seven times, but he rises again. Say it about yourself. Rejoice not against me, O thou mine enemy, for when I fall, I shall arise. Say it about yourself. I'm above and not beneath. I'm the head and not the tail. Hallelujah. Say it. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Say it again. Say, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Hallelujah. Come on, let your faith rise with me right now. Let your faith rise with me right now. So when we seek our miracles, we don't seek the miracle. We seek the God who does the miracle. We don't seek the healing. We seek the God who performs the healing. We don't seek the answer. We seek the God who is the answer. And when we seek that God, God sets up camp in the middle of our worship. Do it again. Raise your hands. I feel an interruption right now. Raise your hands and let the Spirit move. God is faithful. God is righteous. Now, what to me is the most beautiful thing in all the Word, what I've been teaching you about God and His perfectly pure oneness and power, that God became flesh and dwelt among us and walked among humanity so that He could feel what we feel and understand the condition of humankind in a way that no creator could understand it. So He became weakness that I might rise above it. He became sin that I might rise above sin. He became pain, chaos, anger, confusion, loneliness, despair, so that I might rise above all of them. For He was like you, tempted in all points, yet without sin. Amen. So the scandal of God, the scandal, is that he is a God that can be touched. He put on flesh, this God who knows all, controls all, fills all space, who is perfect in all his ways, put on the imperfection of flesh. You know, I know there are, history is filled with people that want to be God, but there's only one God that ever wanted to be a man. Just one. Lots of people want to be God, but there's only one God that ever wanted to be a man, and his name is Jesus. And that's who we feel tonight. That's who we feel. This perfect God who put on imperfect flesh that you and I might be saved. And this God of ours, the God that no one could see him and live. Moses wanted to see him, so he hid him in the cleft of the rock and he covered him with his hand, and he only allowed him to see the after effects, just the hind parts, just a bit of his glory, because no one could see him and live. So that God put on flesh. And just for a moment, the disciples saw the same God of the Mount Sinai. They were at Mount Transfiguration. They saw it for a moment. It was the same. It was a blinding light with intensity, just like Mount Sinai. It was a blinding light. It was smoke. It was glory. That's what they saw. But in Moses' story, you touched the mountain and you died. But in Jesus' story, you don't only get to touch the mountain, you get to touch the God who made the mountain. That's the difference. Because God came close. God came near. This perfect God drew near to us. And in Moses' time, if you even touched the mountain, you were struck dead. But in Jesus' time, you get to touch him. But I have a question. What's the practical function, if you're God, in touching people? If you don't have to touch anyone and they can get a miracle. The Roman centurion proved it. He said, my servant's at home sick and I'm a man of order. Speak the word. And immediately the servant was healed. The publican proved it. He said, my daughter lieth at home at death's door. And the Bible said, the Lord said, even from now, this moment. And when they calculated it, the Bible teaches us that from the very moment he spoke, that his words moved across the distance and healed the baby at home. So if you don't have to touch people, why do you do it? If you don't have to interact with people, why do you do it? You see, there are 37 separate miracles chronicled in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And in 37 miracles, 13 of them specifically, Jesus touched someone. I can list them for you if you insist. But the truth is, Jesus didn't have to touch anyone. John teaches us that he had the same power as God in his words, in his mouth. People brought sick people to Jesus saying, touch him, touch him, touch this one. But the truth is, no one ever had to beg. That's the point of Jesus. This God of creation became this sweaty Lord of dirt, and he walked amongst people to touch us. Whether it was a leper, a blind man, a crippled in their back, a paralyzed hand, a widow's funeral procession on the way to Nain, it didn't matter. He just kept touching and touching and touching and touching and touching, because there's something about your God in all of his perfection who wants to touch everyone in this room. And the beautiful thing is this. God did not put on flesh and interact by touching people to revoke it upon his ascension and say, now you're on your own. Right. Goodbye. All right. I touched you. I ministered to you. But now you're by yourself. No. He said, I'm sending another one back. another comforter to be my touch on this earth, to interact with your spirit. That's why when we receive the Holy Ghost, we are literally being changed and transformed by the power of God's Spirit. We're not what we used to be. We are a new creature. It's the Greek word for specio. It's the English word species. We become a new species. Your salvation, it's not you going higher. Your salvation is God coming lower. But Jesus didn't bring his touch to take it away. So hear me clearly. The same spirit that rested in Jesus rests in you in this room. God's touch for this earth. And your Holy Ghost was not given to make you mystical. The Holy Ghost wasn't given to help you escape the world. The Holy Ghost was given to you to empower you to become God's touch on this earth. So Paul said it, and it's more than a beautiful series of words. Paul said, we are the body of Christ. And when you touch someone by the hand and you pray the prayer of faith, it is as if Jesus Christ is still alive, touching someone right now. That perfectly pure God who put on flesh lives inside of us. That God that can't be anything but faithful. That God who cannot fail. When you touch the person next to you in faith, what's happening is God is touching their body right now. Are you ready to do it? Because there's about to be a release of healing in this room. Because it's just not a preacher from America touching you. It's the Holy Ghost touching you. It's God in this body. Know ye not that your bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost? Jesus didn't go to all the work, God putting himself in flesh to touch people, to say goodbye. He said, no, here comes my spirit. And when you pray for someone in this room, hear me, it's as if Jesus Christ is touching them again. If I can get you to believe that, there will be all manner of miracles tonight. Let's do it right now. Take someone's hand. Before you pray, I want you to ask them what it is God needs to do in their life right now. The person you're joined with, I want you to ask them what it is they need from the Spirit. I want you to ask them if it's a healing and what it may be, if it's a breakthrough, if it's a deliverance. Say, what do you need God to do? Ask them very, very specifically, what do you need God to do? Do you know? Now, I'll teach on this if you can't share. You can't pray effectively if you don't know how to pray specifically. Did you understand that? We pray in a lot of generalities. Lord, bless them. Lord, help them. Lord, deliver them. But I can't speak to the mountain if I don't know how to specifically pray. I need to say, Lord, heal their left foot. I need to pray specifically, heal their lower back. I need to say, Lord, save their family, their daughter, their son. The only way, because let me tell you something. When you don't pray specifically, you don't know when to give God glory for it. Because you can't prove God did it. And it leaves it too general. You say, well, God bless them, and then they get blessed. But you don't know if God did it or not because you didn't pray specifically. And likewise, they can't give God honor because they didn't ask specifically. You can't ask, just say, well, just pray I'm blessed. Because when God blesses you, you might think it was your boss. You might think it was your relative. You might think it was your spouse. And so God doesn't get the credit. And God doesn't share his glory with anyone. So God's not going to answer you because you're not giving God the proper credit for doing the work. So before you share, I want you to tell him, this is exactly what I need God to do right now. And then we're going to pray very specifically for your miracles. How many need a miracle? How many need an answer? How many need God to do something? Okay? Tell the person beside you right now what it is. Are you ready? Do you know what to pray for? God is perfect. God took on flesh. God came back as the Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit. Now pray, because God is faithful. God is righteous. God is just. You ready? 1, 2, 3, in the name of Jesus, pray. Pray for healing. Pray for deliverance. Pray for the answer.